Bless the Lord, who forgives all our sins.
His mercy endures forever.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Kyrie eleison. Kyrie eleison. Christe.
Gracious Father, whose blessed Son, Jesus Christ, came down from heaven to be the true bread which gives life to the world, evermore give us this bread, that he may live in us and we in him, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Please be seated as we prepare to hear a word from Sacred Scripture.
A reading from the first book of Samuel. The Lord said to Samuel, "How long will you grieve over Saul? I have rejected him from being king over Israel. Fill your horn with oil and set out. I will send you to Jesse the Bethlehemite, for I have provided for myself a king among his sons." Samuel said, "How can I go? If Saul hears of it, he will kill me." And the Lord said, "Take a heifer with you and say, 'I have come to sacrifice to the Lord.' Invite Jesse to the sacrifice, and I will show you what you shall do. And you shall anoint for me the one whom I name to you." Samuel did what the Lord commanded and came to Bethlehem. The elders of the city came to meet him, trembling, and said, "Do you come peaceably?" He said, "Peaceably, I have come to sacrifice to the Lord. Sanctify yourself and come with me to the sacrifice." And he sanctified Jesse and his sons and invited them to the sacrifice. When they came, he looked on Eliab and thought, "Surely the Lord's anointed is now before the Lord." But the Lord said to Samuel, "Do not look on his appearance or on the height of his stature, because I have rejected him. For the Lord does not see as mortals see. They look on the outward appearance, but the Lord looks on the heart." Then Jesse called Abinadab and made him pass before Samuel. He said, "Neither has the Lord chosen this one." Then Jesse made Samah pass by, and he said, "Neither has the Lord chosen this one." Jesse made seven of his sons pass before Samuel, and Samuel said to Jesse, "The Lord has not chosen any of these." Samuel said to Jesse, "Are all of your sons here?" And he said, "There remains yet the youngest, but he is keeping the sheep." And Samuel said to Jesse, "Send and bring him, for we will not sit down until he comes here." He sent and brought him. Now he was ruddy and had beautiful eyes and was handsome. The Lord said, "Rise and anoint him, for this is the one." Then Samuel took the horn of oil and anointed him in the presence of his brothers. And the Spirit of the Lord came mightily upon David. From that day forward, Samuel sent out and went to Ramah. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The psalm will be recited by half verse, breaking at the asterisk. The Lord is my shepherd.
I shall not be in want.
He makes me lie down in green pastures.
And leads me beside still waters.
He revives my soul.
And guides me along right pathways for his name's sake.
Though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I shall fear no evil.
For you are with me, your rod and your staff, they comfort me.
You spread a table before me in the presence of those who trouble me.
You have anointed my head with oil.
Surely your goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life.
And I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Ephesians. Once you were darkness, but now in the Lord you are light. Live as children of the light, for the fruit of the light is found in all that is good and right and true. Try to find out what is pleasing to the Lord. Take no part in the unfruitful works of darkness, but instead expose them. For it is shameful even to mention what such people do secretly. But everything exposed by the light becomes visible, for everything that becomes visible is light. Therefore it says, "Sleeper, awake, rise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to John.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
As Jesus walked along, he saw a man blind from birth. His disciples asked him, "Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind?" Jesus answered, "Neither this man nor his parents sinned. He was born blind so that God's works might be revealed in him. We must work the works of him who sent us while it is day. Night is coming when no one can work. As long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world." When he had said this, he spat on the ground and made mud with the saliva and spread the mud on the man's eyes, saying to him, "Go, wash in the pool of Siloam," which means sent. Then he went and washed and came back, able to see. The neighbors and those who had seen him before as a beggar began to ask, "Is this not the man who used to sit and beg?" Some were saying, "It is he." Others were saying, "No, but it is someone like him." He kept saying, "I am the man." But they kept asking him, "Then how were your eyes opened?" He answered, "The man called Jesus made mud, spread it on my eyes, and said to me, 'Go to Siloam and wash.' Then I went and washed and received my sight." They said to him, "Where is he?" He said, "I do not know." They brought to the Pharisees the man who had formerly been blind. Now it was a Sabbath day when Jesus made the mud and opened his eyes. Then the Pharisees also began to ask him how he had received his sight. He said to them, "He put mud on my eyes. Then I washed, and now I see." Some of the Pharisees said, "This man is not from God, for he does not observe the Sabbath." But others said, "How can a man who is a sinner perform such signs?" And they were divided. So they said again to the blind man, "What do you say about him? It was your eyes he opened." He said, "He is a prophet." The Jews did not believe that he had been blind and had received his sight until they called the parents of the man who had received his sight and asked them, "Is this your son who you say was born blind? How then does he now see?" His parents answered, "We know that this is our son and that he was born blind. But we do not know how it is that he now sees, nor do we know who opened his eyes. Ask him, he is of age. He will speak for himself." His parents said this because they were afraid of the Jews. For the Jews had already agreed that anyone who confessed Jesus to be the Messiah would be put out of the synagogue. Therefore, his parents said, "He is of age, ask him." So for the second time, they called the man who had been blind, and they said to him, "Give glory to God. We know that this man is a sinner." He answered, "I do not know whether he is a sinner. One thing I do know, that though I was blind, now I see." They said to him, "What did he do to you? How did he open your eyes?" He answered them, "I have already told you, and you would not listen. Why do you want to hear it again? Do you also want to become his disciples?" Then they reviled him, saying, "You are his disciple, but we are disciples of Moses. We know that God has spoken to Moses. But as for this man, we do not know where he comes from." The man answered, "Here is an astonishing thing. You do not know where he comes from, and yet he opened my eyes. We know that God does not listen to sinners, but he does listen to one who worships him and obeys his will. Never since the world began has it been heard that anyone opened the eyes of a person born blind. If this man were not from God, he could do nothing." They answered him, "You were born entirely in sins, and are you trying to teach us?" And they drove him out. Jesus heard that they had driven him out, and when he found him, he said, "Do you believe in the Son of Man?" He answered, "And who is he, sir? Tell me so that I may believe in him." Jesus said to him, "You have seen him, and the one speaking with you is he." He said, "Lord, I believe." And he worshiped him. Jesus said, "I came into this world for judgment, so that those who do not see may see, and those who do see may become blind." Some of the Pharisees near him heard this and said to him, "Surely we are not blind, are we?" And Jesus said to them, "If you were blind, you would not have sin. But now that you say, 'We see,' your sin remains." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Please be seated. In our first reading today from the first book of Samuel, Samuel is sent by God to Bethlehem. Bethlehem. To find a new king of Israel after Saul had offered a sacrifice to another god and eventually built a trophy to himself. As a result, Saul fell out of favor with God and was being replaced by God as king of Israel. Samuel goes to Jesse of Bethlehem and asks to see his sons, one of whom will be anointed with oil as the new king of Israel. Eliab is brought first to Samuel, and Samuel thinks, surely the Lord's anointed is now before the Lord. But the Lord says something very important here, saying to Samuel, do not look on his appearance or on the height of his stature, for the Lord does not see as mortals see. They look on outward appearance, but the Lord looks on the heart. Samuel must have been panicking at this point, but remains and asks if there are any other sons after he sees seven of them. And Jesse tells him that the youngest, David, is out in the field tending sheep. David, of course, comes in and is described as ruddy and had beautiful eyes and was handsome. After the Lord confirms to Samuel that David is the chosen one, Samuel anoints him. And it says, the Spirit of the Lord came mightily upon David from that day forward. Now, let's turn to today's gospel selection from John, in which Jesus heals a man born blind. It's not really about just one more miracle of Jesus. It's really a miracle that points to the gift given to us in the sacrament of baptism. First, notice that it's Jesus' own disciples who ask if the man born blind was born that way because of his sin or the sin of his parents. In the ancient world, such disabilities were seen as a punishment because of sin. God was seen as a vengeful, wrathful God who was always seeking to punish disobedient people. Also note that it clearly says that the man was born blind. He didn't become blind. What sin could this baby possibly have committed coming out of the womb? How could it possibly be the sin of the blind man if he was born that way? But Jesus answers them, neither this man nor his parents sinned. He was born blind so that God's works might be revealed in him. Now remember when the Lord said to Samuel that mortals look on the outward appearance, but the Lord looks on the heart. Jesus, the Lord, can immediately see the man's heart and even the hearts of this man's parents. Jesus, the Lord, knows that the man's blindness is not a result of anyone's sins. Now, if we're going to connect that to baptism, we can say that our inheritance of original sin is not our own fault, nor the fault of our biological parents. It's simply the state into which we are born. In fact, original sin is not something that we have per se, but is something that we lack. We lack the grace of God that gives us the power to see as God sees. The washing away of original sin and baptism is what restores that grace within us and gives us the power to see as the Lord wants us and desires us to see. And just as the Spirit of the Lord came mightily upon David from that day forward, so too does the Spirit of the Lord come upon us mightily from the day of our baptism forward. Now moving along in the story, Jesus then spat on the ground and made mud with saliva and spread the mud on the man's eyes, saying to him then, go wash in the pool of Siloam, which means sent. Then he went and washed and came back able to see. Then he went and washed and came back able to see. Now in some translations, instead of the word mud, they use the word clay. And this is an important distinction, because going back before the time of Jesus even, there was an ancient Jewish tradition that suggested that God made Adam out of spit and clay. Do you get it? You get it?
Yeah.
Yes! This is the stuff that gets me excited. The very action of Jesus is a symbol of the original creation of God. Jesus represents here the recreation of this man's eyes. Jesus doesn't just fashion little clay eyeballs for the man. He instructs him to go and wash in the pool of Siloam. It's interesting that the gospel writer does not want us to miss the significance of what the name Siloam means. And so he puts in parentheses, which means sent. The pool where the man washes off the clay is a pool called sent. Isn't it interesting that the disciples are sent by Jesus to baptize all nations in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit? And that those of us who are baptized are sent into the world to spread the gospel, the good news of Jesus Christ. This is not mere coincidence here. Those who are witnessing this event, where the blind man can now see, they suddenly have doubts that this is even the same man. This man, he is of age. He's been around town for years and years, begging in the street. Now that he's standing upright with his hands by his side, instead of out begging for alms and for help, suddenly they don't recognize him. This is because they never really looked at him before. Prior to the day of his healing, he was just a sinful blind man who sat on the side of the road, who had been cursed by God. For most of his life, no one took real notice of him. Not only was he born blind, but those around him were also blind, never really seeing him. And now that Jesus has recreated him, they see him for the first time. And baptism does that for us. We come out of the waters of baptism having been recreated, and as such can be unrecognizable to those around us. For those who are baptized as adults later in life, many people around them say things like, "Wow, they're so different. They seem happier and holier." The man born blind has a progression in seeing who Jesus really is. At first, the man born blind says that the one who healed him is the man called Jesus. Then later, when asked again, he says of Jesus, he is a prophet. And then, after he's been driven out of the temple and Jesus finds him, the blind man acknowledges that he believes Jesus to be the Lord. And then what does it say? And he worshiped him. He worshiped Jesus. See, in an ancient Jewish context, even the hint of worshiping someone or something other than God would be blasphemous, punishable by death. This gospel passage even says that the man's parents were afraid, for the Jews had already agreed that anyone who confessed Jesus to be the Messiah would be put out of the synagogue. And here, this man whose sight has been restored, who has a new lease on life, he's going to risk it all. He sees in ways that others cannot, and he begins to openly worship Jesus. It's a powerful image. I mean, in some ways, it's a scary image for us to imagine ourselves as that blind man. It's unfortunate that for those of us who were baptized as infants, we can easily lose the significance of the day on which the Spirit came mightily upon us, as it did for David, when our blindness was removed from our eyes and our hearts. Now, I'm not dismissing the tradition of infant baptism here. I'm simply making a point. As baptized Christians, we are called to see the world and all the people of the world with eyes that have been washed clean and recreated by Jesus. Jesus gives us a perspective that is different from the perspective of the rest of the world. The world looks at outward appearances, but the Lord looks on the heart. Who or what are we turning a blind eye to in our own community and in the world? If one of the street people in downtown Rapid City were suddenly healed of their poverty or addiction, would we recognize them, or have we been ignoring them for far too long? Are we going to allow Rapid City and Pennington County to grow blind to the plight of the mentally ill, or will we allow ourselves to see them and advocate for them? Does our own fear, our own prejudice, and our own bias blind us to the needs of refugees from around the world? And this may be a difficult one for many. If our president were suddenly healed of his blindness and had some conversion experience, would we be willing to recognize him? Would we even give him a chance? How are we choosing to look at the world and its people? Are we looking with blind eyes, or are we looking with the eyes washed clean at baptism? Are we looking at outward appearances only, or are we truly striving to see hearts? Amen. As we recall the day on which the Spirit came mightily upon us, let us turn to page 304 and renew our baptismal promises. Do you believe in God the Father? In Jesus Christ, the Son of God.
I believe in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into the dead. On the third day, He rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand. He will come again to judge the living and the dead.
Do you believe in God the Holy Spirit?
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Will you continue in the apostles' teaching and fellowship, in the breaking of bread and in the prayers?
I will, with God's help.
Will you persevere in resisting evil, and whenever you fall into sin, repent and return to the Lord?
I will, with God's help.
Will you proclaim by word and example the good news of God in Christ?
I will, with God's help.
Will you seek and see and serve Christ in all persons, loving your neighbor as yourself?
I will, with God's help.
Will you strive for justice and peace among all people and respect the dignity of every human being?
I will, with God's help.
Please turn to Form 5 of the Prayers of the People, which begins on page 389.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord, saying, Lord, have mercy. For the Holy Church of God, that it may be filled with truth and love and be found without fault at the day of your coming, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For Justin, Archbishop of Canterbury, Michael, our presiding bishop, for John, our own bishop, for all bishops and other ministers, and for all the holy people of God, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all who fear God and believe in you, Lord Christ, that our divisions may cease and that all may be one as you and the Father are one, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the mission of the church, that in faithful witness it may preach the gospel to the ends of the earth, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For those who do not yet believe, and for those who have lost their faith, that they may receive the light of the gospel, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the world, that a spirit of respect and forbearance may grow among nations and peoples, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For those in positions of public trust, that they may serve justice and promote the dignity and freedom of every person, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For a blessing upon all human labor, and for the right use of the riches of creation, that the world may be freed from poverty, famine, and disaster, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the poor, the persecuted, the sick, and all who suffer, for refugees, prisoners, and all who are in danger, that they may be relieved and protected, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this congregation, for those who are present, and for those who are absent, that we may be delivered from hardness of heart and show forth your glory in all that we do, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For our enemies and those who wish us harm, and for all whom we have injured or offended, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all who have commended themselves to our prayers, for our families, friends, and neighbors, that being freed from anxiety, they may live in joy, peace, and health, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For those concerns and those thanksgivings that are now mentioned either silently or aloud,
I pray in thanksgiving, O Lord, for the gift of the life of Ruby Dart, a family friend who recently passed away. O Lord, we ask that you receive with gladness her soul into your perpetual life, and that you offer comfort, peace, and consolation to her family who grieves.
For all these things, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all who have died in the communion of your church, remembering especially this day Nancy Thielen, and those whose faith is known to you alone, that with all the saints they may have rest in that place where there is no pain or grief, but life eternal, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Rejoicing in the fellowship of the ever-blessed Virgin Mary and all the saints, let us commend ourselves and one another and all our life to Christ our God.
To you, O Lord our God. For yours is the majesty, O Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory, now and forever.
Amen.
Amen. We'll use the form of confession found on page 360. Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Good morning. Good morning. Welcome to any and all visitors and guests who may be with us this morning. Following our service in our parish hall, we will have coffee and treats. I invite you to check the sign-up sheet for coffee and treats. If you have not had an opportunity to sign up lately, I invite and encourage everyone to take a turn. Notice in your bulletin an insert about the ECW fundraiser that's coming up in May. They are looking for handbags and purses and items to go in such handbags and purses. So read the little explanation as to what they're looking for. And as always, you can ask an active member of the Episcopal Church Women who can answer any questions that you might have. On the flip side of that announcement is our Holy Week and Easter schedule. I will call your attention to several services that are noted as having incense. We always try to balance that out with another opportunity for a service that will not have incense for those who are sensitive to it. So please, if you are sensitive to the incense, I encourage you to kind of highlight those services and make note of that. Also, you'll note in your bulletin, I put a little letter in there last week and this week. It's time to invite family and friends and neighbors and co-workers to church for Holy Week and Easter Sunday. Don't wait until Easter Sunday morning. Don't wait until Holy Saturday. Don't even wait until Holy Week. Start planting those seeds now, and let's have our church filled with people who are seeking the love of Jesus Christ, and let us have an enormous celebration of the empty tomb and the resurrection that defeated death forever. Finally, regarding Holy Week and Easter, outside in the hallway, there is a sign-up sheet for our Maundy Thursday hour of repose. We ask folks to sit with Jesus in the garden. That will be in the parlor again, and you can do 1 hour blocks. We have a side for men and a side for women. We try to balance it out, so especially for our women who have to come here by themselves, that they might feel safe. We will have a security guard as we have the last several years, so there's nothing to fret or worry about, but I would like to see people praying in pairs. Finally, this Wednesday is our soup supper. This week it is again at St. Andrew's, but more importantly, after the prayer and after the dinner, we're having a meeting on Vacation Bible School. We need all parents, all volunteers, all concerned parishioners, anyone who is concerned like I am about the fact that we canceled VBS last year because of a lack of participation. Come and allow your voice to be heard. We're going to be talking about when is the best time to do it on the calendar, when is the best time of day to do it, day or night. And so we need lots of input, we need lots of energy, and we need the Spirit to descend upon that meeting, and that Spirit will only come through the gift of your presence. Tomorrow is our Acts Ministry meeting. Tonight is our Acts Ministry mission meal at the Cornerstone Rescue Mission. If you would like to put on those new eyes and see the hearts of those in our midst who are hungry and in need, this is an excellent opportunity to go to the Cornerstone Rescue Mission and volunteer and see with new eyes. So the Acts mission meal is tonight, the Acts Ministry meeting is tomorrow, and then the men's group is Tuesday night. So come and let the Spirit move within us and through us and around us. We read in Psalm 50, offer to God a sacrifice of thanksgiving and make good your vows to the Most High.
We receive the gifts of your generosity. Those who would like to come forward for a special blessing may do so following our ushers. Father, receive the gifts you first offered unto us. Be pleased with our offering and sacrifice, and bless them and make them holy, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Do we have any birthdays? One birthday? We'll put the birthday over here, and we'll kind of start to spread everybody else out this way for their special intentions. When's your birthday, David? It was last week. Very good. All right, shall we pray the birthday prayer for our friend David? Watch over thy child, O Lord, as his days increase. Bless and guide him wherever he may be. Strengthen him when he stands. Comfort him when discouraged or sorrowful. Raise him up if he falls, and
and in his heart may thy peace, which passeth understanding, abide all the days of his life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Happy birthday. Baby blankets. Heavenly Father, we give you thanks and praise for the sharing and the gift of talents and abilities. We ask, O Lord, that as you wrap these loving children in your mantle, that you keep them warm by the fire of your love. Bless also those who are sharing these gifts with others through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Did it go well? Good. I'm so glad. Heavenly Father, you have begun something new in recreating your precious daughter. We ask, O Lord, that you mold her and fashion her, her arm, her heart, and her eyes, all through the powerful name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Father, we give you thanks and praise for the gift of miraculous healing for baby Dylan. We ask, O Lord, that you continue to strengthen those who love that sweet and gentle newborn. We ask, O Lord, that the power of your love console all hearts, minds, and hearts, minds, and souls as they seek healing for baby Dylan. All these things we ask in the powerful name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. You're starting a new job. When do you start? Tomorrow. Congratulations. Heavenly Father, you have given us work to do in the vineyard. We thank you for the dignity that employment and work brings to us. We ask, Heavenly Father, that you send your spirit of blessing upon Lynn as we give you thanks and praise for the gift of this new opportunity. Bless her with confidence, wisdom, and skill through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Father, watch over Jan and Sarah. Bring about a full healing of body, mind, and soul. Protect them in your loving care, now and forever. Amen. And tell me his name again. Jacob. Lord God, your Son, Jesus Christ, has the power to heal all people. We ask, O Lord, that you hear the prayers of a concerned mother, that you heal Jacob wherever he may be. As he wrestles with his addictions, O Lord, we ask that you free him from all that has trapped and ensnared him. Set him free in body, mind, and soul, and comfort his mother this day and forever, through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
And this is Teresa's grandmother. Sure. Heavenly Father, open wide your heavenly and eternal gates and receive the soul of your daughter, Maxine. We ask, O Lord, that you have mercy upon her family and friends, that you console them, that you dry their tears, and give them glad hearts as they prepare to celebrate the resurrection of your Son, Jesus, which promises for us a resurrection for all. We ask this through the powerful name of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we now pray. Amen.
Amen.
And what is your friend's name? Jackie. Father, hear the prayers of your daughter Cheryl for her friend Jackie. We ask, O Lord, that as she lies helpless after the stroke which she endured this week, we ask and beg of you, O Lord, for a healing of either body, mind, or soul, and that you bring comfort, peace, and consolation to all those who uplift her to you in the power of prayer. All these things we ask in Christ, through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Oh, Joni? Sure. Father, you know how we should pray even better than we can pray ourselves. You know the depths of our hearts, minds, and souls, and so we ask that you hear Marie's prayer for her friend. We ask for a healing for Joni upon her knee. We ask, O Lord, that you eradicate her body from any and all infection, and that you bring about a complete healing. All these things we ask in the most powerful name of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we now pray.
Amen.
Thank you. Lord, wash away my iniquities, cleanse me of my sins. Once again, during this Lenten season, we are utilizing Eucharistic Prayer C. That is on page 369 in our Book of Common Prayer. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
God of all power, ruler of the universe, you are worthy of glory and praise.
Glory to you forever and ever.
At your command, all things came to be. The vast expanse of interstellar space, galaxies, suns, and the planets in their courses, and this fragile earth, our island home.
By your will they were created and have their being.
From the primal elements you brought forth the human race and blessed us with memory, reason, and skill. You made us the rulers of creation, but we turned against you and betrayed your trust, and we turned against one another.
Have mercy, Lord, for we are sinners.
Again and again you called us to return. Through prophets and sages you revealed your righteous law. And in the fullness of time you sent your only Son, born of a woman, to fulfill your law, to open for us the way of freedom and peace. And therefore we praise you, joining with the heavenly chorus, with prophets, apostles and martyrs, and with all those in every generation who have looked to you in hope to proclaim with them your glory in their unending hymn. And so, Father, we who have been redeemed by him and made a new people by water and the Spirit, now bring before you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be the body and blood of Jesus Christ, our Lord. On the night he was betrayed, he took bread, said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his friends and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, gave thanks, and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me."
remembering now his work of redemption and offering to you this sacrifice of thanksgiving, we celebrate his death and resurrection as we await the day of his coming. Lord God of our fathers, God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, open our eyes to see your hand at work in the world about us. Deliver us from the presumption of coming to this table for solace only and not for strength, for pardon only and not for renewal. Let the grace of this Holy Communion make us one body, one spirit in Christ, that we may worthily serve the world in his name. Accept these prayers and praises, Father, through Jesus Christ, our great high priest, to whom, with you and the Holy Spirit, your church gives honor, glory, and worship from generation to generation.
Amen.
As our Savior Christ has taught us, we now pray, Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us be
Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world.
Have mercy on us.
Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world.
Have mercy on us.
Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. The gifts of God for the people of God. Once again, all baptized Christians are welcomed and invited to receive Holy Communion with us today. We also have gluten-free hosts available. If that's part of your need, please let me know when I get to you. Bring us to everlasting life.
The sending forth of the Eucharistic visitors can be found on the inside of your bulletin. In the name of the people of Emmanuel, we send you forth bearing these holy gifts, that those to whom you go may share with us in the communion of Christ's body and blood. We, who are many, are one body, because we all share one bread, one cup. Amen. Our post-communion prayer is in the Book of Common Prayer on page 365. Let us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart, through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Bow down before the Lord.
Look down in mercy, Lord, on your people who kneel before you, and grant that those whom you have nourished by your word and sacraments may bring forth fruit worthy of repentance, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
May the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit descend upon you and remain with you forever.
Amen. Let us bless the Lord.
Thanks be to God.